And I realize I just want to do it. You know what I mean? I mean, it sounds good and all, but I just have to confront the fact that I really don't like the people I've been talking about helping out. You know what I'm saying? I don't think I like people, period. I mean, you guys are okay. I'm just trying to be honest about being a misanthrope.
So you're not going to go to law school? What do you want to do then?
I want to dance.
Dancing has compelled creators and audiences alike since the inception of cinema. The first dance on film was captured by Thomas Edison at his Black Maria studio in March 1894. While many speculate that modern dance pioneer Ruth St. Denis was the first to be preserved on celluloid, film historian C. Musser and the U.S. Library of Congress claim otherwise, pointing to Spanish dancer Carmen Sita as the first dancer to appear in front of an Edison motion picture camera. The following year, the St. Petersburg Swan Lake Ballet was screened to an audience, opening up the possibilities of the cinematic language. Quickly, moviegoers became enraptured by movement and rhythm on camera. When cinema transitioned into talkies, the birth of the all-American genre of the film musical made actors like Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers, Gene Kelly, and Bing Crosby worldwide sensations. They took a respected art form and filtered it through the camera's eye to thunderous and long-lasting effect. But dancing gained different connotations when it began to be framed outside the musical. So today, let's look at the impact of dancing in non-musical movies, what it means, how it heightens emotional states, why it leads to so many iconic moments, and ultimately, why we just can't look away. So let's dive into the entrancing beauty of dancing in non-musical movies. Dancing can be defined as the movement of the body in a rhythmic way, usually to music and within a given space, for the purpose of expressing an idea or emotion, releasing energy, or simply taking delight in the movement itself. Dancing in non-musical movies is often so pleasurable because it represents something weird, something chaotic, something unexpected in an otherwise tightly controlled environment. It's not totally unexpected to see dancing in a rom-com, of course. But perhaps you weren't counting on Ex Machina's Oscar Isaac dancing to early 80s disco in the middle of an allegory for the myth of Prometheus. And what about Ralph Fiennes letting loose to the Rolling Stones in a bigger splash? Or even the great Christopher Walken giving a new dimension to a crime boss in The King of New York. These sequences are played to different effects, but they all have one fundamental thing in common. They're arguably the most memorable parts of the movies they're in. Columbia University neurologist John Krakauer gives three reasons why dance is so pleasurable. First, people speculate that music was created through rhythmic movement. Think something like tapping your foot. Second, some reward-related areas in the brain are connected with motor areas. Third, mounting evidence suggests that we are sensitive and attuned to the movements of others' bodies because similar brain regions are activated when certain movements are both made and observed. Humans like watching others in motion and being in motion themselves, and adding music to the mix may just be a pinnacle of reward. Ultimately, though, sometimes words just aren't enough to express an emotion. Dancing allows to convey layers of contradiction in a universally understandable language.
Captain Edelstein?
In William Friedkin's Cruising, Al Pacino finally embraces his bisexual nature after getting fully immersed in the New York BDSM underground. Consumed by the heat, the sweat, and, well, the poppers he just inhaled, Pacino finally lets go, revealing yet another part of his personality. In both Silver Linings Playbook and Demolition, dancing becomes a way to cope with mental illness, to expunge inner demons of movement and chaos. In David O. Russell's depiction of a man coming to grips with his new reality, the ballroom routine is taken apart and then re-energized by punk music. The anarchic nature of punk fits the fragmented mind of two people that function slightly different from the rest, in the process finding a true expression of themselves. In Demolition, Jake Gyllenhaal, who's having trouble dealing with the loss of his wife, dances manically on the streets, making everyone around him feel uncomfortable. This is at once a literal cry for help and the result of a necessity to live outside his body, even if for just a few minutes. Both instances seem to literalize Virginia's Woolf thoughts on dancing. It stirs some barbaric instinct lulled asleep in our sober lives. Certain films use surrealistic dance sequences to heighten extreme and indescribable joy. In 500 Days of Summer, Tom finally gains Summer's acceptance the co-worker has been pining for since the day he met her. The film later delves into the toxic nature of projection in relationships, but at that moment, Tom's dreams have come true. The filmmakers visualize it by giving him an over-the-top Hall & Oates dance number complete with a marching band, Harrison Ford, and Disneyfied Blue Birds. Similarly, in 40-Year-Old Virgin, Andy breaks into a surreal dance number after having sex for the second time, which, comes right after the first. The elation of having had sex is both a release from social pressures and as a reaction to the pleasure of the act itself, culminates in the hilarious rendering of Aquarius' Let the Sunshine in a song advocating harmony, understanding, and revelations. But dancing is perhaps at its most soulful when used to deepen the intimacy between characters, or to say what they can't bring themselves to say otherwise. Luca Guadagnino's Call Me By Your Name does just that, and in two different instances. First, Elio watches Oliver dance free from constrictions or embarrassment to the psychedelic Furs' Love My Way. After wrestling with desire for a few minutes, he joins Oliver in what becomes the first real moment of closeness between them, even if one they have to navigate out in the open. Later, during a trip to Bergamo, as their relationship reaches its inevitable demise, they come across Love My Way once more, and yet again, Elio finds himself sitting down, watching Oliver dance. This time, however, he doesn't join him. Guadagnino uses dancing and the lack thereof to bookend their romance. Oliver will leave Elio behind and marry a woman. Still, that song and that dance will forever be an imprint of their souls. The same could be said about the most transcendent scene in Lee Chang-dong's Burning. The three leads, who stem from different social backgrounds and are involved in a bizarre love triangle, sit on the porch and listen to Miles Davis' Générique as they watch the sun set. Suddenly, Hai Mi decides to take off her shirt and perform the Dance of the Great Hunger against the blue-orange sky. Hai Mi lives the moment to the fullest while the man can't help but observe, completely transfixed by the scenic beauty in front of them. About this scene, IndieWire critic David Ehrlich wrote, "Time stops, class dissolves, national borders fuzz over and blur. For one blissful moment, anything can happen and anyone can do it. For better or worse, there's nothing to stop them." These ideas of bliss and possibility seem to be prevailing sentiments in dance sequences of many beloved films. Take Before Sunset, impossibly romantic ending in which Celine and Jesse share a dance worth more than a plane ticket, or Moonrise Kingdom's quirky and twee literalization of first love, or the characters in 20th Century Women attempting to close the generational gap by letting loose the black flag. Of course, most of the time dancing is just cool. It provides what cinema thrives on, movement and rhythm. After years of working as a film critic and bringing attention to underappreciated American gems, Jean-Luc Godard gave birth to what would become Film History 101. In Band Apart, Anna Karina, Sammy Frey, and Claude Brasseur line dance in a Vincennes café. In a piece for The New Yorker, Richard Brody wrote, "Whatever an experimental film might be, this sequence is one. It's an experiment the discoveries of which have yet to be fully assimilated by the world of filmmakers." A case could be made that Quentin Tarantino certainly tried to assimilate it, first by taking the name of Godard's film for his production company, then by incorporating unexpected dancing into his films. There's Reservoir Dogs under the guise of psychopathic and sadist behavior, Death Proof on a psychosexual note, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood in which QT puts his nostalgia goggles on, and of course, most famously, Pulp Fiction with a well-known Jackrabbit Slim's twist competition. We could also dig into dancing as an expression of the surreal, like in Foxtrot, Inland Empire, and 8½, or how opening and closing credits become completely transfixing when framed within a dance routine. Think of Do the Right Thing, Slumdog Millionaire, and Tropic Thunder. Or even the memorability of showcases and contests in movies. I mean, Napoleon Dynamite dominated indie culture for a long time, and still does through gifs and memes. And the same could be said about the indie that made history at the Oscars, Little Miss Sunshine. And of course, the irreverent and ever quotable Mean Girls. Dancing in non-musical movies can never be ignored. It always provides a jolt of energy and the disruption of the status quo. It's an attitude and a statement. No matter its deeper meaning, be it uplifting, sobering, intimate, liberating, or just plain cool, a good dance sequence elevates any movie.